The following is a presentation of Surprise Church. El siguiente programa es la presentación de la iglesia Surprise.
Who leaves kids to run a booth anyway? Pretty irresponsible if you ask me.
No one did ask you. Just help me sell something. Well, who are you?
They must work for the government. Look, I don't even know what a census is.
I guess a census is just a way to count people. Oh, I wonder if that's why so many people have come into town.
Let's all stand together.
So Joseph also went out from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
You can be seated.
While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. She had her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger because there were no guest rooms available for them.
Those nice census takers from Dewey, Cheatham, and Howe showed me how to work this thing. And if my calculations are correct, we're broke?
Yep, and the sun's going down, so nobody needs sunglasses. We're ruined.
Wait, we should be thinking about what the people really need.
Sunglasses!
No.
Ooh, sunscreen.
No.
I know, lots of bathrooms.
No, maybe, but no.
I've got it, sunglasses.
Ray, focus. They're going to need a place to stay.
I was just about to say that. Hey, did you see that incredibly bright star over there?
Uh-huh, here, the sign up.
Who's going to want to sleep in the floor of our booth?
That's a good question. Maybe once all the other places fill up, they'll be desperate enough to sleep in our booth.
Hey, what about those two? That lady's ready to pop. I mean, very, very pregnant.
Uh-oh. We're not the only ones getting into the innkeeper's business.
Do you have any rooms for us?
I'm about to have a baby.
No, I'm sorry. We're full, but you can stay in the stable if you wish.
Let's all stand and sing O Little Town, Away in a Manger.
Where did that couple disappear to?
I don't know. They look kind of desperate. I hope they find a place, even if it isn't ours. But the more important question is, if the sun is setting over there, what's that incredibly bright light shining from over there?
Yeah, I noticed it earlier. It's a double sun, like that double rainbow I saw this summer. Remember how amazing that was? Man.
I don't know, but I do know it's beautiful, and I think it's getting brighter. I wonder what it could be. Ray, is it me, or is it getting even brighter?
It sure is, and we're gonna make a mint. Sunglasses, get your sunglasses right here. Protect yourself from the mystery light with our special sunglasses. Only 2 denarii, or a special deal of, 2 pairs for 10 denarii.
After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star, and when it rose, we have come to worship him."
What's this? Lost, King of the Jews, the star has led us here to Bethlehem. We wish to worship the newborn king. If found, please contact the Star Trackers near you.
Star Track? Why does that sound familiar? Anyway, king, newborn, the star led them here. How do you follow a star?
Do you think the bright star over there is related to this?
I wonder if there's a reward. Kings are rich, right? Palaces, gold, all the hamburgers you can eat.
Your stomach should be designated the 8th wonder of the world.
Thank you.
I'll bet those are the star trackers from the flyer. Excuse me, did you leave these flyers lying around?
What's all this star stuff about?
We're tracking the star of the newborn king.
What is it?
Shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And the angel appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone upon them. And they were so afraid. But the angel said unto them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. He's the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger."
What is it? What do you see, Ray?
You won't believe it. Mama's hut is still open. Do you think we could?
I'm not sure if it's important for your search, but there's a bright light shining from over that way, and it's been getting brighter and brighter. Who knew the stars could say so much? But it still doesn't tell us who this king is and what he has to do with the light and what all of this really means.
I can't take this anymore. I have to find out what's going on over there.
I'm so confused. First there's a census, so all kinds of people come into town to be counted. Then we saw that hugely pregnant couple looking for a room. But then they disappeared over that way. Now there's a bright light shining from over there. And finally the star trackers show up because this star guided them to the mysterious and important thing that happened here. Is it all related? How? What's going on? Whoa, are you angels?
Vanessa, you're not gonna believe what I just saw. Are those?
Yeah.
What are they doing here?
I have no idea.
Did they bring sandwiches?
Please tell me, what does all of this mean?
Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David, and you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped in snuggly clothes lying in a manger.
Vanessa, I think I just saw that baby. The light seemed to be showing the way to him, like he was the most important thing in the world.
Let's stand and sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Thank you for sharing your baby king with us. I'm still not sure what it all means, but I do know he's the most important person who's ever been born. I'm so glad I got to be here for it.
But what about the sunglasses booth?
Oh, I'm not worried. After everything we've seen today, our future's so bright, we're gonna have to wear shades.
Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this wonderful gathering that we have here today. God, we acknowledge the birth of your son, and we are delighted to be a part of it. Thank you for the dear children that showed us so well that wonderful Advent. God, bless them and bless us as we listen to your word and enjoy some more time together today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Could you do me a ginormous Christmas favor and thank these kids and the volunteers and every parent for doing such an awesome, awesome job? I don't know. You guys realize that it's only December 20th, and this is already my favorite Christmas ever. Thanks for doing that. Okay, what we're going to do is you guys are going to go celebrate a little bit, a job well done. So you guys, all the surprise kids are going to go hang out and do a little Christmas fun party, and the grown-ups are going to have some fun here. Christmas. Any other kid would like to join them that didn't participate in the actual pageant is certainly welcome to go and hang out and celebrate with them as well. And so as they're making their way out, we're going to do a little just internal transition here. And great job. Good hug. We're going to have an announcement video that kind of tells you about some of the things going on in our community. And while you're watching the announcement video, feel free to fill out that Connect card, as we'll be collecting that a little bit later. So here you go. Imagine going to church or a class or some formal speaking engagement. Imagine going and having nobody up front. Wouldn't that be ridiculous? All you do is listen. Just words, sounds, language. Many of us have taken classes online from an instructor who teaches remotely or had meetings with people over a screen rather than a boredom. Half of all couples who get married meet online now. Most of us have turned the phone on speaker and so that everybody in the room could talk to a friend or family member in a distant location. It's how we meet people. It's how we communicate. On one level, you got to admit, it's pretty cool. I mean, technology has, you know, allowed us to connect and collaborate in remarkable ways with people anywhere on earth. You can play a video game against a child in Brazil, and if you're a grown-up, you will lose. You can send a Snapchat to a relative on an ocean liner. You can Skype with your uncle as he travels through Europe collecting stamps. You can sit at your cubicle at work and watch a hidden camera that you've strategically placed in your kitchen to keep an eye on your holiday brownies. Maybe you're feeling that distance in your life. What I mean is, while these things are so helpful on many levels, with all the fancy gadgets that money can buy, it can't prevent the actual reality of separation when someone's far away, when someone's not there anymore. We can watch the screen, or in this case, listen, but it only reminds us of the distance between us. And maybe you're feeling that distance today. Christmas is one of the funnest times of the year, but there's a reason why there are so many destructive decisions made after the holidays, because it can also be one of the most painful and disappointing, a time when we sense the separation in our relationships, separation between you and your spouse as you've drifted apart or fallen on rocky times, separation between you and a coworker that's making your job more stressful, separation between you and a loved one who's passed away, separation leaving you only with letters, memories, mementos, pictures, videos of your cherished time together. And if that's not you, I promise you, someone sitting next to you is right there right now. Maybe you feel separated from God. Maybe you feel like he's hiding behind a cosmic black curtain in the sky, keeping himself hidden and mysterious. Or maybe you feel like you've built a wall between you and God through doing or not doing things that you feel guilty about. Anything from stress to loneliness can make us doubt God's presence, and it can sometimes feel like we're left with nothing more than his words, dry ink on a page. We can listen. We can stare into an empty sky. We can tell Bible stories, but in some ways, it can make the separation more pronounced during those seasons where you feel it so profoundly. And that, my friends, is exactly why Jesus came. Did you know that? He didn't come to punish you. He didn't come to make you follow more rules. He didn't come to make you behave like a nice boy or nice girl.
He came to be close to us. He came to be close to you. He came to deal with the separation that we feel as we walk through life. For proof, do you remember what they called him? The angel said, "You shall call him Jesus," which means God saves. But he also had a nickname, you remember, Emmanuel, which means God's with us. Maybe you've had a nickname that you don't like, you know, and sometimes it's tied to something about your looks or your temperament, like shorty, tiny, oh, what are some other ones, grumpy, bashful, dopey, you get the idea. My nicknames growing up were Maddie and Andy, very creative. Jesus' nicknames were totally not creative. Emmanuel means God is with us. When they're thinking of nicknames for Jesus, they just said, hey, we should call him God is with us, because there he is. Jesus' nickname, and he's proud of it, is God is with us, and he never wants us to forget it. How many of you have seen the new Star Wars movie, by the way? Show of hands? Now, I have no idea how many hands are up. I'm assuming a couple. Did you like it? Did you sleep outside in a box for 2 days to make sure you got tickets to the midnight showing? I know someone out there did, Alan, you sicko. Well, if you've seen the new Star Wars or any of the others, you know that they all start with a prologue. You know those bright yellow words that retreat into space that help us understand the strange new world that we're about to enter into? Well, we've been looking at John chapter 1 this month, which also starts with a prologue message. It explains the world that we're about to enter. It says how the Word, which is yet another nickname for Jesus, the Word was in heaven with God, and yet the Word was God, and God, this Word, made everything. He made the entire universe and then watched in agony as the world that he made and the people that he made turned away from him and chose a rebellious life, a life without him where we know better on our own. And he, God, felt the separation between him and us so profoundly that he decided to do something drastic about it. So let's watch John's Gospel prologue with a little Star Wars flair just to hear that story. Let's watch. Just like that, we're plopped down into a strange new world where God hasn't stayed distant. I wish I could have seen that video. It sounded really cool. But that's the whole point. God didn't miss a thing from his heavenly throne. He didn't miss it. He stepped down from his majestic palace to become flesh, verse 14 said. Human flesh. Because only that was the solution to the separation between God and human flesh. He met us where we are. He lived among the poorest in the world, and he owned very little. He worked with his hands. He took baths. He ate bread. He burped. He slept. He danced. He laughed. He played. He cried. And he even died. The Almighty God of the universe refused to stay separate from us. He refused to stay separate from our problems, our experience, our work, our pain, our celebrations, and even our death. He refused to stay separated from the people he created and the people he loved. And so he eliminated that separation between him and us forever. In other words, heaven's king himself slipped through the curtain in the sky to wear a robe of human flesh. It's that dramatic. I couldn't possibly overdo it today. Heaven's king decided to come off his throne, to come out of his palace, and to wear flesh that would need to be bathed, that would need to be cared for, that would need to be tended, that would need to be mended, that could be hurt, that could be injured, and that could be killed. That's what Heaven's King did. This verse is one of the most beautiful verses in Scripture because it underscores the difference between any other God, any other version of God, any other religion, and the one that we celebrate as true, is that this God became one of us. He said, I ain't staying separate from my people. I'm bridging the gap. I'm coming close. Instead of separation, God made a decision that would inflict a lot of pain upon himself, a lot of agony upon himself, and he would join our human experience by being with us and staying with us forever. It's a beautiful, brilliant plan that many people who first heard it laughed and told those who shared it that it was a scandal or a stumbling block, foolishness. But this is the decision that he made. Now, let me explain one thing about why, because I told you the first reason, the main reason, that because he did not want to stay separate. But there's another reason. One of my favorite movies that my wife and I watch every Christmas is called The Four Christmases. Anybody ever watch that? It's not a family movie, so I'll tell you that right now. But it's a good, my wife and I get a kick out of it. And Vince Vaughn's character, if anybody around him throws up, he throws up. And there's a couple of scenes in the movie that if you have kind of a gross sense of humor like I do, you just start laughing because when someone throws up, there's a chain reaction in the room and you have to watch the movie. I'm not going to spoil it, and maybe I already did for you actually, but Jesus came to start a chain reaction. You see, what we can do is we can come to church during Christmas or Easter, and we can kind of see the story as a museum piece that we sing about, that our kids sing about, that we have decorations, and it can actually enhance the separation between the story and what it was intended to bring about in us. The story was meant to start a chain reaction. It was meant to start a chain reaction of a God who took on flesh so that you and I could truly live in our flesh. A lot of times we float around as ghosts in our own bodies, multitasking, on our phones, distracted, focused on our ambitions or our disappointments to the point where we're not truly present with the people God has put us to live next to, live with, serve, work with. Christmas is not just an excuse. It's the power for us to become flesh. That's what that map is over there. That is this church's attempt to become flesh. If you haven't yet, please stop by after church. Grab a tack. We got jumbo tacks now. Really proud of that. Find where you live. We've got local map, Bismarck, Mandan. We even have a globe on there, so I guarantee you, unless you're from the movie Star Wars, you're going to find where you live. And it's your commitment, and there's a piece of paper on the chair that explains a little bit about the Lighthouse Project. Your commitment to not just be a ghost in your neighborhood. It's your commitment to taking on flesh, to standing with both feet on the ground where you live and say, okay, God, maybe I like some other neighborhood more, or maybe I like some other climate more, but I'm here. And I want to follow some steps to help me live in the very location you called me to live in rather than live in the online world or live in a fantasy world or live in a work world that doesn't bear fruit that comes when I take on flesh where I live. So grab that slip, watch the video online, and pluck a pin. Tomorrow is the longest night of the year, the solstice. And if you're able to, I want to encourage you to take a prayer walk with your family through your neighborhood. Maybe you're not a praying person. I don't care. Just do it anyway. I mean, what do you have to lose, right? Walk around your neighborhood. Just say, God, would you help this neighbor? I know what they're going through. Bless that neighbor. In fact, God, while you're at it, just go ahead and bless this whole street. Bless this whole neighborhood. Bless the school that we live nearby. Would you just bring light into this neighborhood? Get your kids doing it. I promise you, your kids will never forget it. And they will never look at owning a home the same way again if you show them how to take on flesh in your home. If you show them to be truly present in your home. That's God's Christmas message to us. He wants us to take on flesh. Lighthouse campaign is a great way to do that. There's others. Today, we're going to be having our community meal. Join us. Physically be there. Meet people. All of us are quirky. Having a meal with people was Jesus' way of saying, your quirks are fine with me. I can deal with it. I love you. I want to get to know you. I care about your story. We do a meal here once a month because we want to take on flesh and just enjoy one another and show you that you're welcome wherever you're coming from and whatever your quirks are and whatever your burdens are. And there's plenty, believe me. The more I get to know our people, the more I get to know how human we are. We're also going to be having a basket next to the food to help with some of the meal expenses. If you'd like to, it's a free meal. But even more importantly, we're going to be using those to be able to help one of our local elementary schools has kind of had a lice outbreak, and they've asked Surprise Church if we'd be willing to help provide lice shampoo. So we're going to buy a bunch of lice shampoo and bring that down because we take on flesh. Did you notice the gifts on your way in today? Katie, our awesome volunteer, called me a week ago and said, hey, could we do anything to bless some people this through a giving tree this holiday? So she called Ruth Myers, and she got a 9-family member list of different families that just don't have gifts or funds for gifts. Last week at church, I said, folks, I know it's late in the game. I know it's December 13th, and I know you're busy, but I would love to not have any family members left after church today, and they were gone within 10 minutes. That's awesome. Because your church, your community, your group, your family that takes on flesh, you don't just take it in the message and not let it start a chain reaction. So we've got a pile of gifts that we're going to deliver after church today to families who are waiting right now at Ruth Myers' home to receive them. And they're going to remember Christmas differently because we took on flesh. It happens in your neighborhood. It happens everywhere. And another way to take on flesh this season is a huge opportunity. Christmas, I like to call Christmas is the Super Bowl of the church. Now, like I said, we can think of Christmas as a family ritual or a cultural ritual that we just do it, focus on, okay, I have meal here this time, and I go to church this time, and there's just a very kind of a routine way of looking at Christmas. I see Christmas as a massive opportunity. That's why I love doing funerals, by the way, and I love doing weddings, and I love Christmas and Easter because there are people who darken the door of a church and listen to a message that they would otherwise never listen to. So I want to challenge you this Christmas to take on flesh with the people that God has put in your life by being a volunteer. And the announcements, you can go to our Christmas page and pick one of the two services. Just come, and if nothing else, just greet people. Help strangers not feel strange as they come. We'll have other needs. We have a lot of nursery needs, and we have set up and take on all those kinds of things. But just sign up for a time to make a difference this season, because Christmas is not just for me. It's for the people that God has put in my life. So volunteering is one way to do that. But there's others. When you think about the things on your chair, that it's kind of like, why would you put more than one invitation to Christmas on my chair? Because I'm not inviting you to Christmas. I'm inviting you to take on flesh this Christmas. To look at the people that are in your life in a different way. And to help us run out of invitations. I see every invitation as a soul that Jesus loved and died for, that he has put in your life and in mine. And I take those invitations very, very seriously. We had 5,000 plus another 20,000 that we mailed out. And people are starting to get the word that we're an inviting church, we're a welcoming church. And while they may have written church off from something they heard or something they experienced, someone trusts you enough to maybe give God another chance if you take on flesh. So this year, I want to challenge you. Let Christmas be about you, but don't let it be all about you. Let it be about the people that, and the neighbors and the friends and the coworkers and the family members that God has put in your life for you to invite. There's some ideas on how to do that on a slip on your chair. One last thought. Yesterday was a pretty powerful day we did a big rehearsal here with the kids in the morning, and in the afternoon, some of our middle school families and our new middle school missional community went up to Good Samaritan Society, and they invited us to come and carol up there. And so there's 20, 25 of us that showed up, a number of families, kids of all ages. And, you know, many of the residents couldn't leave their rooms. Some could. And so for some of them, they were in the commons area playing cards or sitting together. We sang to them together. But some of them were in their rooms, and it was dark. And we kind of saw ourselves as bringing light into those rooms. I had to laugh. One room, there's a lady sitting there reading the paper, and Justin walks in. We're here to serve you papers. You're being served. And then I kicked him out and started over. One particular room was a man named Brunel. Brunel couldn't speak very much, but you could tell in his eyes that he was fully aware, fully present, and he was loving the carols. And one of our little girls was handing out candy canes to the residents. Now, these are people that have pictures all over their room. Well, you can't be lonely if you just have pictures, right? You see faces all around you. Right. So we walk into this Brunel's room, and she comes up and gives him a candy cane. And he looks down, and he goes like this. Trembling hands, just thinking, would you come a little bit closer? She takes another step, of course, for a little girl and a strange old man. This is like traveling to a strange planet, but she's like, okay. Took a step. He didn't bite. She took another step. He didn't bite. Took another step. And somehow in those arms, he found the strength to pick her up, put her on his knee. He probably had done that hundreds of times with his own kids. Probably done that hundreds of times with his grandkids, probably now grown up. And all the pictures on the wall in the world aren't going to replace an actual physical, beautiful little girl in an old man's lap as he sees real people singing the Christmas message. There's no substitute for taking on flesh. Walked into another woman's room. She was celebrating her 100th birthday. It was in November, but when you turn 100, you just keep right on celebrating. It's a party for the rest of your life, man. You made it. She looked 80, I told her. I think they made a mistake on your door. I'm like a day over 80. She wasn't flattered at all. She just said, be quiet. Sang happy birthday to her and Jesus. One of the other rooms we went into, and this is very common. This is a great place for giving care to seniors, but you know, this is one room that the woman just was in a place where she wasn't able to respond. She was not even seeming to be conscious. But you know, if you've ever visited your parents or grandparents or great-grandparents, hearing is the last thing to go. You hear story after story of someone who's not able to interact can somehow hear something they've been hearing for decades, and it somehow resurrects something inside. Pictures on the wall and even maybe songs on the radio don't do it. It's a physical presence of a caring person that takes on flesh and comes into the room. So we walked into the room. I noticed the kids stopped about one step into the room. Because, I mean, she looked different. So I said, it's okay. I came in and put a hand on her and said, if it's okay with you, we're just going to sing some Christmas carols. She didn't respond. So we just started singing softly, Silent Night. Sing with me. Silent night. Don't make me sing alone, folks. Holy night. All is calm. All is bright. Round yon virgin mother and child. Holy infant so tender and mild. Sleep in heavenly peace. Sleep in heavenly peace. I noticed tears in her eyes.
seem responsive. As we sung about a God who took on flesh, cried. Everyone, when we asked what's your favorite Christmas song, they all had the same answer, all of them. I'm just glad you're here. Take on flesh. Don't be a Christmas ghost. This is Super Bowl season. This is a chance where people who have memories that are causing them great pain, where people have hardships that are causing them great sadness and anxiety. This is a time where relationships can be so strained that in January, pastors' phones are ringing off the hooks for marriage counseling. Take on flesh. I invite the band back up as we close with a song that sings about the place where God took on flesh, Bethlehem. Let's pray. God, thank you that you were not too good for us. Thank you that you were not too holy for us. Thank you that you, as you balance a billion galaxies on your fingertips, weren't too busy for us. Forgive us for using those pathetic excuses for you. Instead, God, may we be people who build margin into our lives to do the things that matter most, to say no to things that don't, and to live undistracted, undiluted lives in which we take on flesh and dwell among the people that you took on flesh and dwelled with and died for and rose for and now promise to lead through life with the light that lights up every neighborhood and every life and every family, no matter how dark. Teach us as a church more and more to take